Thanks for the kind introduction, Thomas. Hello, everybody. As you may know, most of the AI applications today are running in the cloud, in data centers. This is because it is convenient. Processing power is available. Learning is done in the cloud, for which you need large data sets and computing power. Once learning is done, inference tasks are run on the same assets, the same hardware. But this cloud-based AI scheme is not sustainable in the long run. As more and more intelligent devices will surround us, the amount of data to be processed will increase exponentially, and the data centers will not be able to sustain the load. Part of it will have to be offloaded to the devices themselves. As a consequence, more and more people are working on hardware accelerators for performing inference tasks at the edge. There are other reasons apart from the obvious power dissipation issue. One is latency. The latency of decision making is obviously much shorter when done locally. Another one concerns the safety of operation. You might not want to constantly rely on a wireless connection. Say, if you want that an autonomous car breaks at the right time. And finally, there are privacy reasons. You keep your data local to keep them private. So, what is the main challenge with accelerators dedicated to inference applications? The main challenge is the energy dissipation. And in data-centric applications such as AI, the main source of energy comes from moving data. As you can see in this drawing, it costs much more energy to move data than to do processing on this data. Doing operations lies in the picojoule range, even considering double precision floating point operations, while getting data from outside memories lies in the nanojoule range. It costs hundreds of times more energy to move data than to do computation on it. So the key here is to avoid moving data. The trends in edge computing are the following. First, since you want to avoid large data movements, you can start by quantizing data for having more lightweight data. You can consider 8-bit or 4-bit integer operations, for instance, instead of 32-bit floating point ones, and suffering almost no classification loss. In the same manner, you can also exploit variable bit precision, with lower precision in the convolutional filters, for instance, and higher resolution in the output classifier. And finally, you want to exploit the sparsity of weights as well as the sparsity of operations. On the memory architecture side, you want your memories to be as close as possible to the processing engines to avoid moving data back and forth over long distances. For this, you can use embedded non-volatile memory for implementing dense synaptic weights and use SRAM or embedded DRAM for storing the activation results. The ultimate evolution of this scheme is to perform the computations directly inside the memory. This is the in-memory compute paradigm. The obvious advantage is reduced data movement, thus increased energy efficiency. Another advantage is that you can do operations in parallel, so they are done much faster. As an example, in a classical digital implementation of in-memory compute in an SRAM macro, an 8-bit micro operation, which is the base operation in neural networks, is sped up by a factor of 256x, and the energy efficiency is increased by a factor of 9x. That was for computing and storing the activation values. For the weights, as I said, you can use non-volatile memories. This is convenient since weights do not change often. There's no cyclability issue, and the benefit that comes for free is that you do not have to reload the weights each and every time you power up your circuit. At LSTA, we have demonstrated with our resistive RAM technology that it is scalable and that it can handle multiple bits, up to 4 bits in the future. We are working to further increase the density of this embedded memory by a factor of 10x by replacing the access transistor with a back-end of line selector. To give you a few numbers, if we consider the YOLO V3 topology, which is frequently used for benchmarking inference accelerators at the edge, It's 100 megabytes of width amounts to 20 square millimeters of area with the current resistive RAM technology. And this will be scaled to below 2 square millimeters. So this is easily and cost-effectively integrable on chip. The ultimate evolution of edge computing will be to perform learning locally. When we have autonomous agents, we will want them to learn from experience to adapt to their environments. They will therefore have to demonstrate lifelong learning capacities executed locally. Note that in that case, some of the learning phases can still occur in the cloud for the sharing of experience and knowledge between agents, which is called federated learning. Now, considering those accelerators for learning at the edge, they share all the challenges I've mentioned before, but they are faced with one additional challenge linked to the learning phase itself. Indeed, in order to be able to run the backpropagation algorithm, you need to store all the intermediate activation results. This is because you need them for calculating the gradient, for correcting the weights at each and every layer. And you might not need that for a single input, if you do not want to cycle your weights too much, but for a batch of inputs. Again, with the YOLO-V3 example, for a batch of 20 inputs, that would amount to 800 megabytes of memory for storing the activation results. So you need very dense activation memory that cycles a lot. This is most probably DRAM technology. But given that amount of memory, it cannot be embedded. It will have to be standalone. But we've seen that the trouble with external memories is the energy access cost. Well, the solution in that case is a 3D technology, which enables tight computing and memory integration. Given the large imbalance in the compute over memory ratio, SOC disaggregation in multiple tiers is a good fit. 3D integration enables large bandwidths and low latency communication at low energy cost, given the high number of parallel connections. In such architectures, the finer the pitch, the better. So we have a roadmap for decreasing that pitch over the years, thanks to hybrid bonding, down to 3 micrometers for the chip-to-wafer assembly scheme and 1.5 micrometers for the wafer-to-wafer scheme. So what we envision is a multiple tiers, parallel architecture composed of a layer of generic processing engines for handling exotic neural network layers, a layer of in-memory computing for energy-efficient operations, a layer of non-volatile memory for storing the weights, and finally, if needed, a layer of DRAM memory for storing a large number of activations and thus enabling online learning. However, when we compared what engineers can achieve with current silicon implementations and what nature is achieving, it's easy to realize there's still room for improvements. This graph shows the energy efficiency versus the raw compute power of several implementations coming from academic research teams, startups, large companies. The energy efficiency is given on the y-axis in gigaops per watt. The computing power is on the x-axis in gigaops. Note that both axes are in logarithmic scale. The energy efficiency of current implementation peaks at several dozen TOPS per watt, which is estimated to be two orders of magnitude below that of the bee brain and six orders of magnitude below the one of the human brain. So, taking inspiration from biology seems like a good idea. How does that translate into circuit or technology specifications? First, when we look at how the brain is made, we see that it is massively parallel, with 100 billion neurons and 10,000 synapses per neuron on average. The neurons and synapses are deeply intertwined in a 3D fabric. We do not have all the neurons on one side and all the synapses on the other side. This may seem foolish when I say it like this, but this is precisely how GPUs are made today, with HBM memories on the sides of the processing chip. Biology has taken the spatial localization of data to the extreme, so we need high-density storage very close to neurons. Secondly, we know that the brain does part of the computing in the synapses. to the first order synapses do weight the inputs. So we need some kind of computational memory technology. You can consider it as analog in-memory compute. Thirdly, the computation engines are analog. Neurons accumulate synaptic inputs in their soma and fire when a given threshold is reached. And finally, communication is digital. It comes in the form of spikes. Spikes are unary events. They are not even binary. There was an event or not. There's no value associated with the height or the length of the voltage pulse. This coding type is robust to noise, even over long distances, which is why it was chosen by evolution. But it is also sparse, and we know from information theory that sparse communication in time maximizes energy efficiency. We have designed and fabricated a proof-of-concept circuit combining spike coding, resistive RAM-based synapses, and analog neurons. The neuron can be abstracted as a capacitor for storing the synaptic inputs over time, plus a voltage comparator for generating an output spike when the threshold is crossed. The computations performed by the synapses and neurons exploit physical laws, namely Ohm's law and Kirchhoff's law, so they exhibit a high energy efficiency. This proof-of-concept circuit was fabricated using 130-nanometer CMOS-based wafers with resistive RAMs post-processed at LSTA in the back-end of line. The resistive RAM array can be seen at the top right corner of the chip micrograph. This chip is now used in a demo in our showroom. Visitors can draw digits using their finger on a Surface tablet, which converts it into a 256 gray levels image. It is then sent to an FPGA that handles the interface with the circuit and converts this image into a train of spikes, following a frequency encoding scheme. On average, we measured that an image is correctly classified with less than one spike per synaptic connection, thus demonstrating the sparsity of this coding scheme. It necessitates only 25 nanojoules of energy per classification. Obviously, the major issue with an analog implementation is its intrinsic variability, which you do not suffer from in a cycle-accurate digital implementation. So such implementations are very well tailored to event-based processing, very close to sensors, with online fine-tuning or learning mechanisms for handling variability. But since we want to target high accuracy pattern recognition and of high-resolution images or LiDAR point clouds, we resorted to a fully digital implementation for our second generation spiking neural network accelerator with resistive RAM synapses. This new circuit that we see here, fabricated on 28-nanometer FDSOI base wafers, is scalable. It is composed of 8 convolutional cores, implementing 50,000 neurons and 25,000 shared synapses per square millimeter. The energy efficiency is very good at 1.6 picojoule per synaptic events. It is below the state of the art by a factor of 3 to 10x. And actually below biological neurons, whose energy dissipation is estimated to lie in the 10 picojoule range. It takes only 750 nanojoules to classify a SAFAR 10 image using a ResNet 11 network topology. In conclusion, Frugal edge AI devices need the right combination of technology and circuit solutions. We have seen that the main challenge of either inference-only or online learning accelerators is to avoid data movement as much as possible. This can be achieved thanks to a combination of in-memory computing, non-volatile memory for storing the weights, and 3D technology for heterogeneous integration of DRAM. And we have shown that brain inspiration is also a good mean to devise solutions for increasing the energy efficiency. LSTA is working to advance those technologies. I thank you very much.